Hello students, and welcome in the video session of class 10 science chapter 2 life process. This is the 7th video of this chapter. Let's have a look on the learning objectives today. Today we are going to learn about transportation in plants, excretion and osmoregulation, excretion in humans, structure and functioning of the nephrons, excretion in plants and dialysis. So let's start. Now, first is transportation in plants. In plants, the transportation system is less elaborate as plants are less active and they require less energy. We all know that plants are stationary. They do not move from one place to another. So, their energy requirement is also less. Hence, need of transportation system is also less as compared to humans, which are more active. Now, the major materials which are needed by plants are the gases, like oxygen and CO2, water and minerals, which are supplied from outside. Now, oxygen and carbon dioxide are produced inside the body of the plant, so they don't need to take it from outside. Only water and minerals have to be supplied from outside. Organic food and hormones are synthesized by the plant cells in their body only, and these also have to be distributed by the transport system. Okay, so what has to be transported from one place to another? Water, minerals, food and the hormones. In plants, gases move by the process of diffusion. So, the movement of the gases in the plants is only by the process of diffusion. So, diffusion is the process in which the particles move from high concentration to its low concentration. Now, there are two main kinds of transportation in plants. Fine. First one is transportation of water and minerals, and the other is transportation of the food. So let's begin with first the transportation of the water and the minerals, how it occurs. Now, this involves the three distinct and interconnected process. For transportation of water, there are three methods, three processes which are interconnected with each other. And the first one is absorption of water and minerals by the lateral transport system. Okay. So, let's try to understand this, how it happens. Now see, water and minerals are absorbed by the root hairs. We all know that root is the part of the plant which absorbs the water and minerals. And on the root cells, some hair-like, fine fiber-like structures are present which are called the root hairs. So, root hairs and the epidermal cells at the root tip, they are helpful in absorbing the water and the minerals. Root hairs will absorb water, and epidermal cells will absorb the minerals. Okay, then the water is absorbed actively by the water potential difference. Now the next question comes, why the water will enter the plant cell? What is the need? So here the need is the difference in the water potential. Difference means now water will also move from its high concentration to its low concentration. Now water is more outside than in the cells of the plant. So water will move from outside to inside of the cell of the plant. Water molecules move from high potential to low potential, and they will migrate from cell to cell, passing from epidermis to cortex, from cortex to endodermis, and from endodermis to xylem. So you can see here in the diagram, this arrow shows the movement of the water. So water moves from outside, means here is the soil. From here the water first moves to the epidermal cells. From epidermal cells, now when the epidermal cells absorb water, they get swell up, they exert pressure on the other one, and the water will move on to the cortex cell. Now when this cell swell up, it will again exert pressure on the endodermis, and the water will move on to the endodermis cell. From endodermis, now the water will exert pressure onto the pericycle cell, and from here the water will reach to xylem here. Now xylem is that complex tissue which carries the water from roots to all the upper parts of the plant. So now the diagram, now the arrow is showing to this side, means upward direction. Water will move now up. But this movement from roots, from soil to epidermis, epidermis to cortex, cortex to endodermis, and then to the xylem, this is called lateral transport. You can see the direction here, lateral direction, side direction. And hence this process is called the lateral transport. Okay. So one method is this, how the water get absorbed. And finally, when the water reaches to the xylem, it moves upward by the process of ascent of sap, which we'll study now. Ascent of sap simply means the upward movement of water. Fine. Now let's move on to the next slide. transportation of water and minerals. Second method, that is ascent of sap. So here you can see in the diagram very clearly how the water is moving upward. From the roots, it is coming through the xylem and it is moving to the leaves, to all the branches. Now this upward movement of water is called the ascent of sap. Right? Now there are also two theories to explain this ascent of sap, how water moves up, why the water is moving up. For this, two theories are given. First one is the root pressure theory, which is very much similar to the lateral movement of the water. Okay. So according to this theory, what will happen? The roots will absorb the water and the cells will become turgid. Turgid means the water cells will swell up with water. And these turgid cells, now suppose the first layer of the cell has absorbed the water. Now these cells will become turgid. They will swell. And when they will swell, they will exert pressure on the adjacent cell. And this pressure, which is exerted by the root cell to the adjacent cell, is called the root pressure. Okay? This is called the root pressure. And because of this pressure, it pushes the water upwards. Right? Due to this pressure, what will happen? Water will move on to the next cell. Then the next cell will again apply pressure to the third cell. Third cell will apply pressure to the fourth cell like this. And then the water will move up, and this theory is called the root pressure theory. But this theory is only applicable in small herbs, small plants, not in tall trees. In tall trees, by this method, water cannot reach up to the tip of the plant. So this root pressure theory is only applicable in the small plants, herbs especially. Now let's see the next theory, which is the transpiration pull theory. Right? We all know that transpiration is the removal of the excess of water from the aerial parts of the plant. Okay? The loss of water in the form of water vapor from the aerial parts, especially leaves. So what happens in transpiration pull theory? What is this theory now? See, water and minerals absorbed by root hairs and epidermal cells move through cortex and reach the xylem. This we have studied, that first the water will enter the epidermis cell, then from there cortex, from cortex to endodermis, and then the water reaches the xylem. And once it reaches xylem, it starts moving upward. Right? So the vessels and the tracheid cells of xylem, they are dead cells. And they are now filled with the sap. Now water is now present in these cells. And this sap means the water only. It moves upward from one tracheid to another. So vessels and tracheid cells of xylem are carrying the water, and both are dead cells. So water will move from one vessel, another to third one like this. And from one tracheid cell to another tracheid cell, because they all are arranged one over the other, forming a tube-like structure. Now xylem of root is connected with the xylem of stem. So water from the root can come to the stem with the help of the xylem only. And this xylem is connected. Xylem of all the paths are connected to each other. So from the roots, the water can reach to each and every part of the plant body. All these cells make a continuous network. The unbroken water column. Now when the water starts moving up, it forms a column. Okay, unbroken column it forms and starts moving upwards. Like someone is attracting it from the upside. Okay, someone is pulling the column of water from upside. It moves in such a way that it looks that someone is pulling the water from upside. Now, who is pulling the water from upside? And the answer is here, transpiration. Transpiration means when there is loss of water from the aerial parts. So what will happen? In the leaves, there will be scarcity of water. If the uppermost cell has no water, then the lower adjacent cell will pass on the water to the upper cell. Then that lower cell will again get water from the third cell, and like this. So because of transpiration pull, because of transpiration, now the water is moving upside because there is need of water at the tip of the plant. And this theory is called the transpiration pull theory. That why water is absorbed? Because there is need at the tip of the plant due to transpiration. And because transpiration is that pull which is attracting the water at the upper side. Okay, and this is called the transpiration pull theory. Okay, now let's move on to the third concept, that is transpiration again. That transpiration is the loss, and because of that, the water moves to the upper parts of the plants. Okay, then transpiration occurs by the process of diffusion through the stomatal pores. Now, this is all about the transportation of water and minerals. Now, let's see how the food is transferred here. Okay. Now, synthesis of carbohydrates occur in leaves. We all know that the food is prepared in the leaves. Hormones, they are synthesized at the tip of the shoot and the tip of the root. Now, both of them, food as well as hormone, has to be transported from one place to another. Okay. Now, we know that food is transported by a special type of tissue which is called the phloem. Phloem is a complex permanent tissue which consists of sieve tubes, companion cells, phloem parenchyma and phloem fibers. Fine. Now, the carbohydrates are translocated through living sieve tubes that has holes. Phloem, out of the phloem cells, sieve tubes are living cells and these sieve tubes have hole in between them through which food can be transported from one cell to another. And this movement of food from one cell to another is known as translocation. Okay. Phloem cells are in close contact with the mesophyll cells of leaves. Soluble food enters the phloem and is transported upward, downward or lateral directions. So in the diagram here you can see that this is the source, means the leaf is shown here. The leaf is now preparing the sugars here. Now this food prepared will move on to the next cell. From this cell, it will enter the phloem. And from the phloem, these are the sieve tubes which have holes here. So food from here will pass on to the next phloem cell, then third. And then from here, the other connected cells will also get the food. In this way, the food moves from one cell to another of the phloem and reaches to all the parts of the plant. So this process of transportation of food from leaves to all the other parts of the plants is called translocation, right? Now, let's move on to this is all about the transportation in plants. Now, let's start the next life process of the chapter, that is excretion, right? This is the last life process which you have to study in the lesson, excretion. Excretion means, excretion means removal of the waste product from the body. Now, two important homeostatic processes. Homeostatic means which keep the body in a balanced state. So, there are two important processes which are occurring in living organisms. The first one is excretion and other one is osmoregulation. Excretion is the removal of the waste toxic substances from the body. And osmoregulation maintains the amount of water and ions in the body. Osmoregulation is that process which maintains the amount of water and ions in the body. And both these processes are very important in the body as they keep the body in a balanced state. Hope if there is no excretion, hope if there is no osmoregulation, then how the body can work? The toxic substances get accumulated in the body and the person will die. So these two processes are very important for any living organism. Here in the diagram also you can see that osmoregulation is the regulation of solute particles, means ions, and balancing the water loss and gain. And excretion is the removal of nitrogen containing waste from metabolism. Fine. So they both are homeostatic process which maintain balance in the body. Now let's move on to the next slide and see excretion in different animals. So different animals have different process of excretion, different methods of excretion. Fine. Like in amoeba you can see that the excretion is simply by diffusion. This waste substance will be diffused out of the body. No any mechanism for excretion. Like in earthworm, they have some special structures for excretion which are called nephridia. Then insects have malpighian tubes for excretion. And vertebrates, all the vertebrates have kidneys as the excretory organs. Fine. We also are vertebrates, so we also have kidney as the excretory organ. And the excretory products of animals are, what do the animals excrete? So excretory products are all the nitrogen containing compounds such as ammonia, urea, uric acid, water and other products. They are the excretory products which have to be removed from the body. Right? Let's now move on to excretion in human beings. Right? This is the diagram of the human excretory system which generally comes in exams to draw also. So here you can see a pair of kidneys, fine, a pair of kidneys, a pair of ureters. Ureters are the tube-like structures which connect the kidneys with the urinary bladder. Then there is a urinary bladder where the urine generally gets stored, and the opening urethra from where the urine is removed out. Okay. Then you can see that a pair of kidneys are located towards the back of the lower part of the abdominal cavity. Abdominal cavity is our stomach part. So back of the abdominal cavity means are the part near the backbone area, back side of the abdominal cavity at the lower side. And each kidney is present one on either side of the backbone. Okay? Just back side of the stomach, the kidneys are present on the backbone side. Left kidney is slightly larger. You can see here that this is the left one. Okay? Remember, your right side is the left side of the diagram you are drawing. Okay? So this is the left kidney and this one is the right kidney. So left kidney is slightly larger and it is placed little higher than the right one. Now, you can see here two tubes, one is the artery and one is the vein, okay. So, blood from aorta enters the kidney. This red one means this artery is bringing the oxygenated blood to the kidneys, and this blue one is showing the vein, right. So, blood from the aorta enters the kidney through renal arteries. The arteries which are entering the kidney, they are the renal arteries, and returns to the vena cava through the renal veins. So, aorta will bring the blood will enter the kidneys, and then again the blood will go into the, through the renal vein, it enters the, this one, vena cava, main vena cava, okay. Now, as urine is formed in the kidneys, urine is formed as the main excretory product, okay, in the kidneys, and is also removed out through the urethra. Now, let's see the structure and function of kidneys here. Each kidney is purple yellow in color, slightly flat and shaped like beans. The shape is like bean. It is about 12 centimeters long, 6 centimeter thick, and the weight is 150 grams. Okay. Inside the kidneys, there are numerous excretory units which are called nephrons. You can see here in the diagram some tube like structures here. They are the nephrons and they are the main structural and functional units of kidneys. Main cells of kidneys which are functioning. Each kidney consists of millions of nephrons. There are millions of nephrons present in each kidney. And the important function of kidney is filtration of the blood. Remember, lungs purify the blood, whereas kidneys filter the blood. They filter the waste product from the blood. Kidneys also perform the function of osmoregulation as they absorb the excess of water also. So they perform the function of osmoregulation. If the waste is not excreted, then it will start accumulating to the toxic levels and the person can also die. So, kidney is a very important organ of our body. Fine. Now, let's see how the nephrons look like and how they function. So, nephron, this is the structure of the nephron shown on the slide here. Nephron is the basic structural and functional unit of kidney. You can see here, there is a cup-like structure here. This is known as Bowman's capsule. This cup-like structure, yellow colored, this is Bowman's capsule. And in this Bowman's capsule, you can see here a red spot here. This is the network of blood capillaries and which is called glomerulus. It is marked here, glomerulus. So glomerulus is the network of blood capillaries which is held in a cup-like shaped structure which is called Bowman's capsule. Now, blood entering into the glomerulus carries waste materials. The blood which is coming in the glomerular here is containing the waste materials, fine. Now, because glomerulus is the capillary network, so capillaries are thin-walled. So, what will happen here, all the waste from the blood get filtered here and that filtrate will come in the Bowman's capsule. And that filtrate is known as the glomerular filtrate. It is called, because it is coming from glomerulus, so it is called glomerular filtrate. Now, once the waste material is filtered out, the blood goes into the renal veins. So, once the blood gets filtered here, then the blood will go into the renal veins out of the kidneys. Now, so with the help of the veins, that blood again goes to the vena cava. Now, the fluid containing waste materials is forced out of the glomerular capillaries in the Bowman's capsule. So, that glomerular filtrate is now in the Bowman's capsule. So, it is called glomerular filtrate and it contains sodium, potassium, chloride ions, glucose, amino acids, urea, uric acid and water. So, this much the glomerular filtrate contains. Fine. Now let's see further. Bowman's capsule leads into a long tubular structure. You can see here that below the Bowman's capsule there is a long tubular structure. It is twisted, folded, and it has a U-turn here. Okay, and after the U-turn, it then meets with the collecting duct. This broad part here is the collecting duct, which collects the urine from many of the nephrons. Now, during the flow of glomerular filtrate in this long tube, when this filtrate flows in this tube, so reabsorption of the useful materials takes place. This tube is meant for reabsorption of the useful substances. In the glomerular filtrate, all the useful substances which are present, they are reabsorbed by the walls of this tube. So the materials which are reabsorbed are glucose, amino acids, ions, water, etc. They are reabsorbed. And the fluid which reaches the end of the collecting duct, the fluid which will reach here till the collecting duct, is now called as the urine. The urine is the fluid and dissolved waste substances excreted by the kidneys. Okay, so urine is produced in the kidneys. Human urine contains about 95% water and 5% nitrogenous waste. Finally, the urine moves through the ureter. Now, from the kidneys, the urine will come out into the tubes which are called the ureters. From the ureters, it will come to the urinary bladder, where it gets stored for some time. Okay, and then it is removed out of the body with the urethra. Okay, now urine is yellow in color due to the presence of a pigment in it, which is called the urochrome pigment. Fine. Now, let's move on to this is all about the human excretory system. So now let's see excretion in plants. Now, plants do not have a very specific excretory system, but they remove the waste by some of the methods. Let's see what are they. Now, the gases which are waste in the plants, they are generally given out with the help of diffusion method. Then you can say excess salt is removed along with water. Here you can see this is one of the method that along with this water, some excess of salt is also removed from the body of the plant. Fine. Or the waste is also removed in the form of crystals here. This is the waste material which comes out through the stomatas here in the form of crystals. So this water contains the waste here, and here the waste comes out in the form of crystals also. Fine. And then some plants, what they do, toxic waste are stored with the dead permanent tissues. All the waste gets stored in the dead tissues. Okay, sclerenchyma tissue. Waste gets stored in the dead tissue, and that dead tissue is removed from the plant body periodically. After some time, the upper layer of the sclerenchyma tissue, it get removed from the body of the plant. Fine. Then some of the excretory products such as latex, you can see here resins, gums, some of the oils are coming out of the plant body. They all are the excretory products. Okay, latex, gums, oils, resins, they all are the waste which is coming out of the plant. And aquatic plants, what they do, they lose their waste product by diffusion method directly into the water, right? So this is how the plants get rid of the waste which is produced in their body. Now, next is renal failure and survival. What happens? Renal word is related to kidneys. So what happens if there is a kidney failure? How the person will survive, right? Now, we know that kidney is a very important organ of our body, as it removes the waste, nitrogenous waste, from the body. So what is kidney failure then? Decline in the performance of kidney due to a disease. Due to some disease, if there is decline in the performance of kidney, if the kidney is not functioning, then that is called kidney failure. Sometimes one kidney fails, sometimes both the kidneys are not. If both the kidneys do not function, then that is a critical situation. If one kidney is working, the person can survive. But if both the kidneys fail functioning, then it's a thing of worry. So the failure of both the kidneys needs immediate medical treatment. Okay. Then if both the kidneys fail, at that time there are two alternatives which the person can choose. One is a matching kidney from a healthy person may be transplanted. Kidney transplantation. Fine. The person or the patient has to find some matching kidney from the donor person, and then the kidney can be transplanted. So this is one method. And the other one is using an artificial kidney. Artificial kidney means a machine which is working just like a kidney. So an artificial kidney machine may be employed in order to get rid of metabolic waste from the blood and to maintain the normal levels of water in the body. An artificial kidney is required because if kidneys are not functioning and if some artificial treatment is not given, then the nitrogenous waste get collected in the body and the toxicity inside the body increases. So this artificial machine or this artificial kidney which can be used is called dialyzer. The diagram is shown here. This is a dialyzer, and this process is called dialysis, means removal of the waste from the blood of the person by using an artificial kidney machine is called dialysis, and the machine is called dialyzer. Fine. So what is done in this method? The blood is pumped out of the body and made to flow into the dialysis machine. You can see here that the blood is removed, pumped out from the body of the patient, and the blood is allowed to move in this dialyzer machine. Fine. This dialyzer machine has some tubes which are made up of cellulose. Okay. So what happens? This cellulose tubes will absorb the waste materials in them, and the blood which is filtered is then again can be given back to the body of the patient. Fine. So this is how this machine works. So the blood circulates slowly through the long cellulose tubes which are coiled in a tank which is filled with dialyzing solution. There is this dialyzing solution also present in between those cellulose tubes. The cellulose membrane allows ions, small membranes and water to diffuse through it. Blood cells, platelets, protein molecules, they are too large and they do not pass through the membrane, so they goes outside, means the blood cells goes outside and all the waste get absorbed into the cellulose tubes. Finally, the cleansed blood is again pumped back into the patient. Okay, this is how the dialysis is done. Okay, hope this is clear to you all. Let's have a recap what we studied today. So we done a transportation in plants, excretion, osmoregulation, a human excretory system, then structure and functioning of nephrons, excretion in plants, and then the dialysis process. Right? Hope you all have understood the concepts. Just go through the concept once again. Read the lesson if you have. Otherwise, read the notes which I'll give you. Okay. So till then, stay home, stay safe.